Okay, so it's not a rocket ship, but it's far from slow.
Hey crew, I've got the key to that 23 Land Rover Range Rover Sport. We are gonna take it for a drive, but first, let's check it out. It looks on the inside and outside. This is the new generation Rover Sport, and like its full-size brother, it's sporting a cleaner and more rounded exterior. So here at the face is a thinner black gloss grille, leading into some also thinner pixel design LED headlights, DRLs, and turn signals. Below that are some non-functional corner vents, also with black gloss, thanks to the black exterior package. There's a stacked front air dam setup, Range Rover spelled out on the hood here in black. And then this is the Eiger gray paint job with a nice metallic flake on the paint surface. At the side, Rover Sports gets standard 21-inch wheels, but these are the 23s, wrapped in Pirelli P0 tires, 285 section front and rear. There's more black gloss for the side garnish. Here on the hood, mirror caps and window trim. Those door handles pop out when unlocked and flush mount when locked. Stepping back to look at the profile, not much has changed here. There's still that gentle slope to the roofline up top. And right now the vehicle's in the access height, but it can raise up 2.5 inches in the off-road mode. At the back is a protruding roof-mounted spoiler. And then above that, we have two fins, one for your digital rearview mirror and the other for your antenna. The LED taillights and turn signals are also thinned out. Between those is Range Rover spelled out in black. Down low is a black gloss diffuser with two rectangular exhaust ports. Overall, the design is definitely more modern, without trying too hard. But I do think that the more chiseled face of the predecessor is better looking than this rounded one. What do you guys think? Is this better or worse looking than something like the Porsche Cayenne? Let me know in the comments and let's check out the interior. Opening up and looking inside at this deep garnet and ebony Windsor leather interior with seat perforations and rear seat heating, plus power operations of your rear seat recline. There's leather up high in the doors, you get sunshades, fabric covering your Meridian sound system, dark painted wood texture and gloss black wood veneer, leather padding for your armrest, one touch up down windows, and some soft touch materials down low. Stepping in, behind my own seat at 6 feet tall, I've got plenty of knee room. The seat back's all in leather. You get map pockets and good sized foot pockets to slide my feet under. Thigh support is just okay. But headroom is more than okay. I've got plenty, and that's with the seat reclined. Even with it up, I still have great headroom, so that gets the thumbs up from me. There are two air vents in the middle. You can adjust the fan speed, but not the temperature. Your rear seat heating settings are there, and it's hard to see, but there are two USB-C ports, a DC outlet, and an AC outlet with the tech package. The drive shaft hump isn't too big, so I can get into the middle easily, and my head clears under the opening panoramic sunroof. If there is no middle passenger, then there's an armrest that comes down with leather padding, storage, and deploying cup holders. I mean, I'd like temperature adjustments, but you're not missing anything else back here. Let's check out the front. Door close noise is very solid, and you have smart keyless entry for the rear and front doors. These front seats are heated as standard with power adjustments, including for the headrests. The front doors rock the same materials as the back. Add in two-position memory for the driver's seat, plus power folding and power adjusting door mirrors. Aluminum accents are on the foot pedals. Press this button to pop open the tailgate. And inside we find 32 cubic feet of space. You get a cargo cover back here, a DC outlet, and you can lift this piece up to separate your cargo. If you need more room, you can power fold down the rear seats with these controls here. And as proof that this is an off-road oriented vehicle, you get a full-size spare tire under the floor. Power close and no lock feature on the tailgate. We'll put the vehicle in accessory mode to turn on the digital instrument cluster that's vivid and reconfigurable. Above that is a head-up display with the tech package. There's this kind of rubberized material up on the dashboard. You have both an upper and a lower glove box for good storage options. Digital rearview mirror, also with the tech pack. And here is the 13.1-inch curved Pivi Pro infotainment system, and it's just beautiful. The layout is user-friendly. You can add in some customizations. It only occasionally will have just a little bit of lag on certain features. It does have wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Below the screen is a wireless smartphone charging pad. You've got two reconfigurable dials for your climate control settings. Lots of this gloss black wood veneer that I don't think is going to age very well or definitely stay clean. Physical volume knob, drive mode selection. Under this wood trim are your two cup holders. And under that is deep storage plus USB-C and A port. Under the console is an even deeper cubby. The steering wheel is leather wrapped in this two-tone configuration. Feels excellent in the hands. And you've got these big aluminum paddles on the back of the wheel. Don't forget your two adjustable armrests. Visibility is stellar. Plus, you've got standard blind spot monitoring with rear cross traffic. This cabin is highly luxurious. I'm into the technology and all of the storage options in here that just make it so nice for daily driving. All right, let's take the new Range Rover Sport for a drive next. All right, let's fire it up. That was interesting. It was like a sequenced startup. First, we had the screens come on, and I presume that was the 48-volt mild hybrid system doing that. And then we felt the internal combustion motor coming on. So you got like a 1-2, and then you're good to go. Before we head out, let's look at the camera system, where we have a 3D projection. You can scan around the vehicle exterior. A bird's eye view over to the side, plus backup shots, front-facing shots in both narrow and wide view. And then we also can go here to off-road and see a front-facing camera kind of at a low level. You can see the tires. You can also make the hood be transparent. Well, it's supposed to be transparent. Typically it is, so you can see, like, if you're going over a rock, whether it's going to scrape, and you could hopefully avoid catastrophe. Now, we are clearly not off-road, and we're not going to be doing that today because I wanted to bring the Rover Sport to its natural habitat. So we're in a shopping center in Newport Beach. I suppose you could argue that its other natural habitat would be off-road, but on these 23-inch wheels, I did not want to scrape them up. So we're doing the primary habitat shopping center version. So let's back on up. Ooh, rear cross traffic alert, very helpful there. And I probably should have been in wide view. I would have seen him coming. Down it to drive. And away we go. Let's start things off with the world famous horn test. Oh. Stately and pronounced. Turn signal sound. Oh, it's much more gentle and elegant. Let's talk powertrains in the new Range Rover Sport. There are quite a few of them. We'll start with the entry-level motor, 3-liter turbocharged inline six-cylinder with two different flavors. To start, you've got 355 horsepower, or you can have, as equipped, 395 horsepower and 406 pound-feet of torque. If those don't cut it for you, there's a plug-in hybrid version that makes 434 horsepower, and if that's not enough, then in the first edition model, you have a twin turbocharged 4.4-liter V8 borrowed from BMW, producing 523 horsepower. And if you don't like any of those engine options, just wait one more year and there will be an all-electric version of the Rover Sport. Regardless of powertrain, well, except for the EV model, those engines are mated to an 8-speed automatic gearbox,
and send power to all four tires. It's almost like there are too many varieties of motivation, but I can save you the trouble, because much as I love that V8, I experienced it in the full-size Rover, it sounds good, it's plenty quick, this inline six is buttery smooth in the power delivery, and it works very well with the 8-speed in its seamless gear changes. There's enough grunt here to easily get up to speed and maintain that speed, but it's not overly excitable, especially here in auto mode, which is basically just pushing down on the dial. You can relax, especially in these seats, which are thick and comfortable and highly adjustable, though they do lack lateral support, which I feel like if you do want to venture off-road in this thing where you're jostling all over the place, that's going to be pretty critical, so to not have that is kind of a bummer. Let's try out the turning radius test now. Fully cranked. Not bad. Now, this vehicle doesn't have the rear wheel steering system, which is available in the first edition model, and that would just make this thing turn around even tighter, but this is definitely good enough for high-end shopping centers and maneuvering in those tighter spaces. Ride quality on smooth roads is sublime. But when you get to uneven surfaces, the SUV feels jittery and it just won't settle down. And when you go over a harsh bump, that impact is only slightly softened with the adaptive dampers and air springs. And so it comes into the cabin and sort of breaks the spell of relaxation that the rest of the vehicle sort of establishes. Is the Rover Sport quick, though? Let's find that out next with a real-world 0-60 test. For that, I've got my race box set up over here, and I'm going to press down on the dial to bring it up and allow me to go to dynamic drive mode. Then I'll pull back on the gear selector for Sport powertrain, and all these things unlock the launch control feature, where I hold my foot hard on the brake while pinning the throttle, building up revs, and then releasing the brake. Here we go. All right, what'd we do? 5.79 seconds to 60. Okay, so it's not a rocket ship, but it's far from slow. Under 6 seconds to 60, and really strong mid-range acceleration. Check the box for me. I do want to try out manual mode, so I'm going to pull on the paddles. Ooh, I like the action. The feel of the aluminum paddles is great. Downshifts are prompt. Upshifts are as well. All right. There is a sporty side to the Rover Sport, at least in a straight line. And I don't mind the sound of that inline six. I know a lot of it's enhanced, but it's a decent soundtrack. Now, unfortunately with dynamic mode, the ride quality that is already on the firmer side in auto takes on an even more unsettled focus in dynamic, and so you don't want to hang out here. Also, the wood veneer creaks uncomfortably when the suspension is even firmer. But we will hang out here for one more moment as I turn off traction control and see about the handling and braking. So we'll go full ABS, soft pedal, don't like that. Wants to understeer, hey, but you can cure it with throttle and liftoff. I would have liked the lateral support there. That was not an overwhelmingly athletic impression, at least not one of an athlete that's still in their prime. It leaned in the corner, the brakes were really soft and squishy, and on these 23-inch wheels, the turn-in was pretty quick, but then the feedback through the wheel was mild. Let's put it this way. If I was to take that curve in the Porsche Cayenne, the base model Cayenne, I would have done it at least 10 miles per hour faster and with way more confidence than in the Rover Sport. This is not that caliber of luxury performance SUV. It doesn't feel like it's tailor-made for that. Here on the highway, we can activate features like the adaptive cruise control system. And we also have lane keep assist. Let's see if it holds us. Yeah. Now, to be clear, this is not a steering assist system. It's not really intended to be driven hands off. I just wanted to see if it could negotiate the curve of a road and stay in the center of the lane. It clearly can. That's all good. Listening for the NVH level. It's quiet in here. A little bit of wind noise here at the seams, but the tire noise, the road noise, it's quelled admirably. And that vibe, that's going to lead me into my miles per hour word of the day, which for the 23 Range Rover Sport is lavish, meaning rich or luxurious. That feels like the target for this SUV. It's clearly not for performance, and though it is very, very capable off-road, I've taken the full-size Rover off-road, and it's got the same technology, the same two-speed transfer case, and all the little off-road goodies. It's not really the intent. The intent is where I started this review, in that high-end shopping center. You motor about, you look a certain way, you feel a certain way inside the cabin when you're not going over a harsh bump. It's a lavish vibe. Now, we will launch into pricing and competition in just a sec, but first, let's talk about fuel economy. It's 18 mpg in the city, 26 on the highway, and 21 combined, and the top speed is 140 miles per hour. The starting figure for the Rover Sport is $84,000 for the P360. If you want the P400, that's gonna be $91,400. And this vehicle, as tested, is $100,000. The Rover Sport competes against vehicles like the Porsche Cayenne, which starts just under $74,000, makes 335 horsepower, gets to 60 in 4.8 seconds, and has fuel economy of 21 combined. It also competes with the BMW X5 xDrive 40i that starts just under $66,000, makes 335 horsepower, gets to 60 in 4.9 seconds, and has fuel economy of 22 combined. And finally, the Mercedes-Benz GLE 450 that starts at 67,500, makes 362 horsepower, gets to 60 in 5.3 seconds, and has fuel economy of 21 combined. So, the Rover Sport P400 makes the most power, but is the slowest to 60 and is also the most expensive. I don't think being too pricey or being not as quick to 60 is the real nail in the coffin of the Rover Sport for me, personally. Now, we're going to really get into the impressions part of this. I find that Range Rover owners and, in fact, the vehicles themselves just seem a little out of reach for us regular people. And that's a turnoff for me personally. But objectively, this vehicle is a polished product. The look is high-end, outside and in, the technology is excellent, and it's quiet, the engine is smooth. The only knocks on it are the ride quality and, I suppose, the fact that it is more expensive than its rivals. If you like that air of success about you, then this is really probably the winner, objectively, of this competition. But if you like the driving experience most, like me, then you'll lean towards that Porsche Cayenne. Which would you guys choose? Let me know in the comments. Cayenne, X5, GLE, or this new Rover Sport. I hope you've enjoyed this POV drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel. Hit that bell to get notified. And I'll see you next time.